メルカリギアーズレクチャーシリーズ、今回はスペシャルゲスト台湾のデジタル担当大臣オードリー・タンを迎えての Q&A 最終回です。現在取り組んでいる活動などについて深掘りします。
So public awareness of data privacy rights is always high in the wake of breaches. Yet as the iOS 14 beta release in early July demonstrated, many popular apps are snooping our personal information every day without legitimate justification. In the age of the pandemic, where contact tracing apps are presenting whole new range of privacy concerns, I was wondering if you could share your general thoughts on the state of data rights in 2020. What do you think about the state of data privacy?
Well, so I must qualify my answer though, because Taiwan do have contact tracing techniques and we do use cell phone tower triangulation and a digital fence to enforce quarantine, which is geospatial in nature. If you break out of that digital fence, not only your phone will receive an SMS, so will the local police, and they will also check your whereabouts. And so we have something like the contact tracing app, except it's not an app.And this is an important distinction because in Taiwan, as in Japan, we have a lot of earthquakes and also typhoon. People are already used to receiving in their phone, without subscribing for it, an advanced earthquake warning seconds before an earthquake hits, or a warning of heavy flood so that they have sufficient time to evacuate before the typhoon hits and so on. And they certainly did not turn on GPS, and they did not enable Bluetooth, and they did not install any appIt's just that the cell phone tower providers, the telecom operators, agreed on a kind of common algorithm to send to people those CAP messages of advance warning. And so when we repurpose this system for the digital fence, it has an advantage, actually two advantages. First, the code is already there. It's tested.I wouldn't say there's no bug in it, but the chance that there's a bug in it is very small because we would have discovered it long ago with all those floods and earthquakes and whatever. And so people understand also the limitation of it, which is the second benefit. People understand that it's not very precise. It doesn't know which room you're in. Triangulation, even in the densest urban setting, only have a resolution of 50 meters. And so because of that, people don't feel that their privacy is being infringed as much, because if you break the quarantine, of course it will know. If your phone runs out of battery, it will know, but it doesn't know which room you're in your self-home quarantine house. The point here I'm making is that even if people are willing to work with the central health authority, it will be much better if the health authority uses existing code and working with what people already know, the common and familiar affordances. It doesn't necessarily have to be triangulation and SMS, but it just happened to be that Taiwanese people are the most familiar technologies for us.And so we use that instead of a contact tracing app based on Bluetooth or things like that. And so my main suggestion is that familiarity and social accountability, meaning that whenever the MPs ask or any journalists ask, we can very easily draw analogy between the existing flood and earthquake warning system and the digital fence system and make it an explanation in a way that everybody can readily understand, rather than if it's greenfieldcode, then you know how difficult it is to translate algorithm to legalese on one side and to journalists the reporting on the other side, and the metaphors are bound to have leaks, and then in which case people would have different expectations than the actual running code, and that would create a human right issue because people would feel that they have signed up on something that they don't fully understand. And so I wouldn't call it data right at this particular point. It's just yourordinary human right issues that people need to give consent. And for people to give consent, they must be sufficiently informed. And the decision that involve people needs also to involve people in it. And it can only happen if people have the competence of understanding the systems involved. So I would always advise appropriating existing appropriate technologies rather than developing new code.
So in an interview you said the social innovation that you were working on has three main pillars, which are fast, fair, and fun. I understood the fast and fair part, but can you please elaborate more on the fun part?
when people see something for the first time, they will gauge how much investment cognitively they must make before they can be included in the decision making, in the agenda setting, in the community, and so on. And so one of the best ways that we have discovered is what we call humor over rumor, making sure that each and every scientific measure rolled out by our counter COVID task force is explained by cute dogs. And so, for example, our physical distancing rule is explained by this Shiba Inu with the name Zongchai that says if you're indoor, you have to keep three dog away from one another. If you're outdoor, you have to keep two dog away from one another. Or that you need to, when you sneeze, don't do what this dog do. You have to cover your mouth. Remember to pre-order your mask. And why do you wear a mask? Well, you protect yourself from your own unwashed hands. So this is all very cute. And these things have the great potential of being remixed, because it engages people's attraction to kawaii-ness, if that's a word. Right. Then people will be motivated to maybe draw some comic version to it, to translate into their language and so on, in a kind of cultural expansion kind of way of this cuteness culture. But if you are very serious and only make a kind of scientific report or things like that, people will think that unless you're a trained epidemiologist, they have no way of improving upon it. And so lowering the threshold of participation is the first good part about this humor over rumor. And also as added benefit is that because in our mind, outrage cannot coexist with joy on any particular issue. And so whenever there's panic buying or anxiety, I mean, this is a stressful time. There was, for example, a rumor that said, we're going to run out of tissue paper soon because the tissue paper material are being used for medical mask production. Of course, it's not true. It's different material. But people, because they are anxious, they tend to click share on social media because that relieves their tension. It turns anger into outrage, so to speak. So maybe it has an R value of 3, like every hour, every person share to 3 other people on average. And by humor over rumor, we make sure that within a couple hours, even though our message is later to arrive on social media, our message is funnier. And so it will spread like having an R value of 5. For example, this is our premier, Su Zhenchang, showing his backside, wiggling his bottom a little bit, and with a text that says, each of us only have one pair of buttocks. And it's a wordplay, because in Mandarin, buttocks, tuan, it sounds the same as stockpiling, tuan. And so he is pointing out that no matter how much tissue paper you stockpile, you can only use so many. And there's also this table that says clearly that the material for tissue paper came from South America, whereas the medical mask came from domestic material. And of course, that is hilarious. I mean, you just laughed about it. This entire meme is packaged like a tissue paper box. So maybe it has a R value of 5 or more. So even if it's 2 hours late, it catches up exponentially, so that after a couple days, people get vaccinated because they laughed about it. When they see then the conspiracy theory, they will not share it anymore, because the fun, the joyful part dominates their affect, their association with tissue paper, and the tissue paper conspiracy theory no longer spreads. So the entire panic buying died out within 2 days or so. And of course, we end up persecuting the people spreading the conspiracy theory in the first place, and they were tissue paper resellers. And so I can go on, but the point is that if you laugh about it, you can create, you can co-create in a mindset of making remixes. But if people feel anger and turn it into outrage, actually people are not feeling particularly creative, because it would just be pointing out something as important. So the importance is to channel this energy of outrage into fun. And so that's called troll hugging, which is again a core Roku culture nowadays. Anyone who trolls the Pro 6 channel automatically gets a commit bit and is invited to make the project better. And also, I would finally say that the Taiwan model is not about specific technology. It's about making sure that participatory democracy is fun. so that, for example, when we say that you wear a mask to protect yourself from your own unwashed hand, we're connecting three different messages together. One is mask for protection, one is use soap to clean your hand, and finally, don't panic into the same message. And that increases the R value of that particular message, because you're much more likely to remind other people of that than other measures that only talk about the soap or about the mask or about don't panic. And so I think this kind of mimetic engineering, humor over rumor, it's not that you have to take a dog as your mascot, although it works pretty well. Cute cat, I think, works better in the Japanese context. But just making sure that people who work with the epidemiology don't see the ordinary citizens as, people who know nothing. Instead, we treat each other as amateur epidemiologists, and making sure that after this daily live press conference, the calling of 1922, and those memes, that people understand the science behind it, and so they can innovate on their own accord.
Thank you, Minister. Thank you for the talk. If you have any final words for the viewers mm-hmm. of this lecture?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, of course. So I would just quote my favorite poet, Lena Cohen, and it says, "Ring the bells that still can ring. Forget your perfect offering. There is a crack in everything. And that's how the light gets in. So live long and prosper."
Thank you.
Bye.